Thank you, Gail. And she played a song that was based on the theme of God is the great I am. And the psalmist David found that to be true. And I pray that you will also find that to be true today as well. From Psalm 25, hear God's perfectly inspired written word. Make me know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and your loving kindnesses, for they have been from old. Shall we stand and sing to the glory of God? Number 51, please. Shall we stand and sing together? Heavenly Father, we gladly come to worship you in spirit and in truth here today. Thank you for the gift of this hour that you have granted unto us by your grace, so that we might come together publicly to worship you in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. We welcome your presence. Thank you for allowing us to live in a land of freedom where we can worship you publicly. In the name of Jesus Christ, we humbly ask this prayer together. And again, all believers joined and said together, amen. Thank you, and please be seated. And while you're at it, would you turn around, look at somebody, put a smile on your face, and give them an old wave. Don't give them germs, just give them a wave. All right, very good. There are friendship pads located on the end of each pew. If you'd be kind to fill them out and pass it along, we would appreciate it very much. This afternoon, our choir is rehearsing. If you want to join our choir, it's never too late to do that. We welcome you to serve the Lord in that unique way. And then our deacons are meeting right after church today. Now, there's an insert in the bulletin. And we're going to ask you to fill that out so that we know that you're coming. It's for a spaghetti feast. It's all you can eat with all the trimmings and all the goodies that come along with that type of meal. But we are asking for a donation of $8 each so that we can provide some additional support to Faith's cousin's daughter. Am I right? Okay, I messed it up last week. Who serves the Lord in Bangladesh, which is a very vulnerable time of a nation to serve the Lord in. So we want to support her, but we also want to have a good time in doing that. So please let us know if you're coming. This is open to anybody. You can bring your neighbors. You can bring total strangers. We don't care. Just come and enjoy yourself that evening. And then we have a new webpage for you computer geniuses. And this is brand new. Ruth Bodine's brother put it together for us. Tells all about the church, our missionaries, and sermons, and whatever else that's going on in our ministry here. So check it out for yourself. You can go directly from it to YouTube and catch up on any services in the past. So please keep that in mind, and we thank her brother for doing this for this without cost to us, which is an added ministry. Let's worship the Lord by giving unto him our gifts and our tithes and our offering at this time. Thank you very much. Shall we worship together by standing and singing our doxology? Thank you. How grateful we are, Heavenly Father, for your numberless blessings. These are a portion of those blessings that we return unto you, asking you to bless them in the loving name of Jesus Christ. And all believers joined and said together, Amen. Thank you very much, choir, for that appropriate song for our time of worship together. Thank you, Gail, for playing, Carolyn for directing, and that was indeed a blessing for all of us. As we pray together, we must continue to pray for our nation, regardless of your political persuasion. If you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, God calls all believers to pray for the leaders of our nation, whether we agree with them or not. We're to pray that they'll seek God's wisdom, pray for our people to listen to God's wisdom through his word. And we're just, God wants us to continue to pray about that, and that we are doing. Now there's a name not on our prayer list. Gloria Jones's sister, Linda Reynolds, is going to be undergoing major back surgery, so would you be in prayer for her? And then Chip Coughlin, as he continues his treatments for his illness, and Wayne Snyder, and Marie Brennan, Sandy Watson, Marty Hughes is going to be undergoing surgery in next week, Baby Russell and Jim Cutler, Courtney Green, all who are receiving treatment for their particular needs. Madison Menser, our 16-year-old young person that's suffering with brain injury. And then John Reynolds, are you back, John? There he is, let's applaud him back. Good to see you back, sir. All right, our pleasure. And Jamie Hosford in Alabama needs our prayer support as always. And Amy Dowell gets well. Fraser Marie Auberer. And then everybody else that's on our prayer list as well. Our missionary for the week, as you can see, Steve and Sandy Moran. Steve is Ruth Bodine's brother. They served the Lord full-time in Nairobi. And through the Africa Inland Mission, he is, actually both of them, but he particular training Africans to become pastors and missionaries and evangelists. And so that's a very valuable ministry that we support financially and now prayerfully. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as you privately know best in your own way. And even though it may not seem like it is not a long time of silent prayer, it is powerful prayer if you're coming before the Lord in the name of Jesus Christ in obedience to his word, seeking his will to be done. There is power in prayer. So let's pray together individually and then collectively. Let's pray. Most loving Heavenly Father, wonderful God Almighty, we believe your scriptures to be true when you teach us that you desire for us to come and to give you praise and thanksgiving for all of your numberless blessings. And so we just come before you collectively and we just praise you. We glorify you. We uplift your holy name. As we pray together, how thankful we are that you are boundless in your love and grace and mercy towards each of us. And as we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ, we're so glad that he left his home in glory, was born of a virgin, so that he might remain sinless to become upon the cross your only acceptable sacrifice for sin, our sins. But Father, whenever we still sin against you, while you are deeply grieved, we also know that you love us so much that you want us to confess our sins and to repent of those sins. And that we gladly do because we only love you because you first loved us. And so, Father, we know your desire is to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How thankful we are for sending your Son to be our one and only Savior. Thank you that he is the one and only Messiah of Israel. How grateful we are, Heavenly Father, for the gift and the presence and the power of God the Holy Spirit, who comforts us and guides us and uplifts us and encourages us and strengthens us to be obedient to your word and to your will. We acknowledge, Heavenly Father, that you are the author and the finisher of our salvation. We acknowledge that your word is pure as you use it to guide us and to correct us and to change us. We pray, Heavenly Father, for the leaders of America that they will seek after your wisdom and your word as they lead us. And then we pray, Father, for the people of America to respond to your word We need a spiritual revival in our land as well as around the world. Reassure us that Jesus Christ not only is alive, but he's coming again. And therein will be the greatest of all deliverances from that which Satan endeavors to put upon us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for Steve and Sandy Murad. We're so glad that they faithfully serve you in Nairobi. We know that your love for people is not in disregard to their culture or their nation, their nationality. You love all people. And so we thank you that the Murads have opportunity to share your love through Jesus Christ to those people that you love so much. Heavenly Father, we ask you now to speak to our own hearts and minds here. Give us strength of body and of mind as we seek to serve you until Jesus comes for us. Now, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we humbly ask you to bless this time of prayer with your power and your peace. In the loving name of Jesus Christ, we humbly ask this prayer together, and all believers joined and said together, Amen. Jesus is all the world to me, and I pray he's all the world to you. Let's stand and sing together 404, please. Shall we stand and sing it? Can you sing the truth of God's word? What do you say in that? Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Would you turn with me in your copy of God's inerrant word to the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 3, rather easy to find, is it not? Find Genesis, turn right. Let me just say that I, as self-serving as this might sound, I've been up since 3:30, which in real time was 2:30, and so I spent the time praying and just being together with the Lord, and there must be a reason for that. I don't always know what God's reasoning is whenever I sense his presence in a special way. But today, through Exodus chapter 3 and Moses, I'd like you to see with me how God wants to seize our attention, set our assignment, and soothe our anxiety. And this portion of Scripture was long before Moses was called upon by God to lead the people of Israel, on some million plus people, out of the land of slavery in Egypt to the promised land, crossing the Red Sea. Long before that, this portion of Scripture happened long before God gave forth the Ten Commandments to Moses to give to the people. This happened when Moses was just beginning to know who God was and his purpose in life. Reading from Exodus chapter 3, the first 9 verses, and then we'll ask God to bless our reading to us. Now Moses was pasturing the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed. So Moses said, I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then God said, Do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. God also said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters, for I am aware of their sufferings. So I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians, and to bring them from that land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Amorite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. Now behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians are oppressing them. May God add his blessing upon this, the reading of his holy word. Will you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, now as we embark in this journey through this portion of your scriptures, we acknowledge by faith that your word is inerrant, and therefore as we look at it with our eyes, comprehend it with our minds, and receive it into our hearts. We know that this is your pure word for our life-changing blessing. We pray for the one sitting around us, for the one watching by television or over the internet that may not know Jesus Christ as his or her personal Savior, that you will take your word in the power of the Holy Spirit, quicken that one to salvation by faith through Jesus Christ alone. For those of us who gladly proclaim Jesus Christ as our living Savior, we need to have our minds stirred and our lives changed by your word and the power of the Holy Spirit. In the matchless saving name of Jesus Christ, we gladly pray together. And again, all believers joined and said together, amen. God wants to seize our attention. God wants to set our assignment, and he wants to soothe our anxieties. This was quite an experience that Moses had on Mount Horeb. For the unbeliever, this scripture that I just read and this experience that Moses had ranks right up there with the best of all fairy tales. Cinderella and Pinocchio and Jack and the Beanstalk and Snow White and Harry Potter. I mean, this is just crazy, what we just read. A bush that does not burn. And God speaking out of the midst of that bush, you've got to be kidding me, would be the thought of the unbeliever. For us believers, however, this is the stuff of which our faith is made. This is what makes us excited about our faith in Jesus Christ. Regardless of what's happening in the world, this is the kind of stuff that says, it's okay. God's bringing us through it all. God is sovereign. If God can speak out of a bush, he can resolve anything that's going on in the world and in our lives. But he wants us to understand that. This was not some pyrotechnic, cute little trick that God played on Moses. This was the real deal. This is how God revealed himself to Moses to seize his attention, to set his assignment, and to soothe his anxiety. Exactly what we all need ourselves. Regardless of our age, regardless of our health condition, regardless of our financial status, God, number one, I want us to see with me, he wants to seize our attention as we read in the first three verses. And he got Moses' attention. Now we know for sure Moses was not distracted by those things which distract us today. Computers and social media and IBMs and this's and that's's and all the stuff that's going on in the world that keep us from taking time to focus on God. But even so, Moses didn't have those kind of distractions. He obviously had some kind of distraction. In order for God to seize his attention, he set a bush on fire that was not consumed. And he called Moses by name. I came across this cute little story about a man who was rushing through the airport. He was late for his flight. And he saw the long line at the ticket booth and to the airline where he wanted to get on. And so he rushed past all the people in line and went up to the ticket counter and slapped the first class ticket on the desk. And he said, I've got to get on this plane now. And here's my first class ticket to get on now. Well, the ticket agent said, well, sir, you're just going to have to get in line and wait like everybody else. And this man looked at her and he said, lady, do you have any idea who I am? With that, she picked up the microphone to the PA system and said, attention, all passengers. There's a man standing at my desk who does not know who he is. If any of you can identify him, would you please come and do so? There is a man who thought that he was all that. Well, God got Moses' attention. He called his name twice. God calls your name too. I've never heard God call my name. Yes, you have. You just didn't realize that he was calling you. I've been here 47 years. You haven't figured me out yet, so I'm still here. But I can't tell you how many times over those 47 years I've had people either tell me right after church or call me or somehow let me know, you know, I thought you were preaching just at me. Now, I know that's not true, that they think so, but that's not true because I never know who's going to be here. I mean, there's some of you that are here all the time, and that's great, and I appreciate it, but there is the proverbial secret grapevine in this church where you get on the phone and tell each other, I'll go this Sunday, you go next Sunday. We're always swapping people, but we're not filling the pews. Don't get mad at me. So I don't know who's going to be here for sure, so you can't say, well, you preached that sermon for me, but God knew. I can't tell you how many times over the years people have come to me and said, you know, I wasn't going to come to church that Sunday. I had other things to do, or I wasn't in a good mood, or whatever. But for some reason, I decided to come to church. And you preached that sermon because you knew I'd be here. Well, no, but God did. See, that's God calling your name. If you could read my notes, you could see that I come to this pulpit with everything written out in my sermon. If you could read my chicken scratch, you could actually read word for word. But in the sermon, I'll say something that I did not plan to say. I gave no thought to it, but I said it anyway. And that will be the thing that someone will come to me and say, boy, what you said, and they'll quote me. That's God calling your name. You've all seen marvelous sunrises and sunsets, but one day you were out there and you saw a sunrise that it was as if you've never saw one before, or a sunset, and you realized how awesome God was. That was God calling your name to speak to you. I just had it happen this past Thursday night. I conducted a funeral for someone I did not know. I knew the parents of the deceased, but that was the only two that I knew, but it was packed. And as I was sitting there before the service, I'm looking at all these people, and I have this thing about when I'm in a crowd of people to see if there's anybody in this crowd that I've never seen before, or that I have seen before. Oh, I recognize that person. I don't know who it is. But in this crowd, I realized there's not one single person in this large crowd that I've ever seen before except these two parents. And suddenly God said, see how awesome I am? I created each one of these people differently. And he reminded me that every single person who has ever lived or who is alive, not one of us has the same DNA. Not one of us has the same set of fingerprints. Not one of us even has the same iris in your eye, which is now being used to identify people. Millions and millions of people, and there before the funeral, God is saying, aren't I awesome? Moses, am I not so awesome that I can put a bush on fire and have it not consumed? Called Moses by name, he calls you and I by name. And when he does, he gets our attention. How many times have you said, wow, I could have been there? But I was over here and I was spared. Not that you were glad that somebody else got hurt, but you realized you could have been there. That's God seizing your attention. And when he got Moses' attention, he said, I am holy. In verse 5, take off your shoes. Shoes collect dirt. Bare feet collect dirt. I am holy. There's a great verse in Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. God says, don't be deceived. Don't be fooled. Don't make fun. I will not be mocked. I'm so tired of people just irreverently referring to God. The man upstairs, my best buddy, he's God. I love to use the word to describe this very room, the word sanctuary. Because the word sanctuary carries with it a place of holiness. God is here in this room. Now he's everywhere, to be sure, but he's also here. And if we had the finances and the ability and so forth, I would have it where this was just for worship. Nothing else, because God is here. This is our burning bush. God has our attention. He says, I am holy. He says in verse 6 of Exodus chapter 3, I am faithful. There's nothing in this world that is as faithful as God is. I'm compassionate in verse 7. I understand the suffering of my people, and I care. I'm a God of action. Verses 8 and 9 of Exodus chapter 3. I get things done. And God's been doing that since Adam and Eve. He's still getting things done to this day. So he seizes our attention. Then he sets our assignment, verse 10. He told Moses, I got things for you to do. Regardless of our age, regardless of our health condition, regardless of who we are, regardless of everything, God says, I have an assignment for you, and I'm going to tell you what that assignment is. I am told that over the deserts, areas of California deserts in the out in the west, there are two birds that fly simultaneously. One is a vulture, looking for dead carcasses, but the other is a hummingbird that looks for the nectar of desert flowers. Depends on what you're looking for. Dead carcasses or sweet, God's sweet nectar. If you come into church ready to receive a blessing, you're going to get that blessing. If you come into church all miserable and upset and whatever, then you're going to miss the blessing that God wants to give to you, because he has set for you an assignment, every one of us. Here's the assignment. You are not just a spouse. You are to your spouse to be, if you have Jesus Christ your Savior, God-loving, Christ-centered, Holy Spirit-filled. You're not just a child in that home. Your assignment is to be a living example of Jesus Christ. You're not just a worker where you work. Where you work, you are to be a living example of Jesus Christ in action, in word, in attitude, in personality. You're to be the oddball where people will focus on what you have that they don't have, because you don't do what the others do. You don't talk like the others talk. Not from a holier-than-I'm-better-than-you point of view, but so that people realize there's something weird about you, but in a good way. That's your assignment. And every one of us have that assignment, even if we're sick in bed. I'm the worst patient in the world. If I've been in the hospital before, and the first thing I say to the nurse is, I'm the worst patient in the world. And they'll say back, well, I'm the worst nurse in the world, so we're going to find out who's going to win. And they always win. Always keep the nurses happy. The doctor just signs the papers. The nurse keeps you alive. And believe you me, I could tell you stories that I won't tell stories because Carolyn will be mortified. But anyway, that's our assignment, even when we're sick in bed, to represent Jesus Christ. Moses, go to Pharaoh, you represent me. That was quite an assignment. And that caused him to have anxiety. And God soothes our anxiety. He seizes our attention. He sets our assignment. He soothes our anxiety. Verses 11 to 14. Now, if you read chapter 4, Moses threw up five excuses as to why he couldn't do what God assigned him to do. You know, what am I supposed to say to mighty Pharaoh? I stutter. I'm not a theologian. What am I going to do if they ask me who God is? What if they don't believe me? What if I'm a lousy preacher? Why don't you send someone else? Those are anxieties when we go home and you endeavor to be a Christ-centered example of Jesus Christ there in your home, it's going to cause you to be anxious. When you go to work, when you go to school, and you want to speak out for Jesus Christ, it's going to make you anxious. So God soothes our anxiety with the calmness of his Holy Spirit. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8. God said to Isaiah, who is going to go and tell the people? In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, Isaiah said, here I am, send me. Who's going to go to your home and be and fulfill your assignment? God wants to hear from your heart. Here I am. Send me. Who's going to go to work and be and fulfill your assignment, even though you're going to be anxious about it, even though God's got your attention? We need to be like Isaiah. Here I am, God. Send me. This is a true story. It just happened this past election year in a little village in Louisiana called Benton. Joe Sickle was elected mayor in Benton, Louisiana, by one vote. Those who were against him demanded for a recount, and they did the recount, and he still won by one vote. But Joe Sickle said, what amazes me is there are 3,000 residents in Benton, Louisiana that are registered to vote, but only 10% of them actually came out to vote. 90% of them assumed I would be elected mayor, so they didn't bother to vote. There are believers who are going to assume somebody else will tell my family about Jesus Christ. Somebody else will tell the employees at work. Somebody else would live for Christ. I'm too busy. But God says, no, I have seized your attention. You know that I love you. You know that I've called you. Here's your assignment, and I will calm your anxiety. Now, if you don't have Jesus Christ as your Savior, God has your attention, whether you realize it or not. And he wants to set you on his assignment. And he will soothe your every anxiety to do that. But he says, first, I want you to invite my son to be your Savior. And when you do that, then you become one of my children for all eternity. For those of us who have already claimed Jesus Christ to be our Savior, and we gladly do so, what are we going to do? Are we going to be like that Joe Sickle, just assume some other believer is going to do what God wants us to do? No, he's got our attention. He has set our assignment. He will soothe our anxiety. But what he wants to hear from us is like Isaiah, "Here I am, God. Send me." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus Christ, for his willingness to leave glory, to die upon the cross, so that we might live. For those of us who have invited him as Savior by faith, we're praying now, Father, for those who are still living in spiritual darkness, who need to come out of that darkness into the sunshine of salvation and hope and victory by faith in Jesus Christ as Savior. Father, there are believers today here, perhaps who have settled into complacency. Deliver us from complacency. Revive us again. You have our attention in every so many ways. You've set our assignment. We need to realize that assignment and accept it to fulfill it with the assurance that you're going to calm our every anxiety. Continue to speak to each of us in a life-changing way. In the name of Jesus Christ, we humbly ask this prayer together. And all of God's people joined and said together, amen. If you desire to speak with me about your personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I'll be only so glad to do so with you after the service. If you desire to come forward for any reason, you're also encouraged to do that. 483. Let's sing it unto the Lord thoughtfully and prayerfully from our hearts. 483, I surrender all. Let's stand and sing together, please. Shall we stand and sing together? Heavenly Father, as we leave this place of worship, we're about to go to other places, and you're going to give us opportunity to live out the words that we just sang together. You have given each of us an assignment to live for Jesus Christ wherever we go. You have seized our attention, calm our every troubled spirit. As we ask you to bless us as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, may we rise up with new faith in our hearts and on our voices, that because Jesus Christ is alive, the best is yet to come. Amen and amen.